Hey everyone, so here we go with the fifth and final section of chapter 10, and we're going to learn about two more Muslim empires, the Ottoman and the Safavid empires. Now, before we really get started, you're probably thinking, great, more long, difficult terms that I'm going to have a tough time remembering who these people are, the Ottomans, the Safavids, right? It's like the Umayyads and the Abbasids. These names are getting really difficult to remember. All right, don't get too worked up about it. I promise by the end of this, I'll be able to put it in terms you can understand. All right, first, let's take a look at the Ottoman Empire. Once this works. There we go. All right. Back in section two, we learned about a group called the Seljuks that eventually would take control of the Middle East from the Abbasid dynasty. The Seljuks were a group of people known as Turks, and so were the Ottomans, right? They were Turkish people, and they migrated into the region, the Middle East, that was then known as Asia Minor, with a bunch of other Turkish groups. Now, this is the reason why the country today is called Turkey. That's where it gets its name from, since the Turks became the dominant group in the region and remained the seat of their power even as their empire grew. These Turkish groups would often fight amongst themselves for control, and by the 1300s, a kind of smaller Turkish group led by a guy named Osman had claimed the throne. His dynasty, the dynasty that he founded, they would dominate the entire Middle East. Oh, sorry, I forgot to mention this part. All right, so Asia Minor, this red shaded region, that's kind of like the traditional homeland of the Ottomans. But Asia Minor, we're talking about this entire region over here, or what would today be modern day Turkey. Okay, so just focus on this red region as the place where the Ottomans are from. All right, but they would eventually come to dominate the entire Middle East by the 1500s. Let me move me down here a little bit. So Ottoman Turks in the 1300s, let's look at the dark shaded area. That's right in around here, okay, similar to what we were just looking at before. I lost the red pen. Let's go back to pen. There we go. And also let me erase this part to it. So that you don't get confused. All right. So the original kind of area that they control was in and around here. And you see how they would expand outwards by 1300, 1359, okay, in here. And then you can see this kind of like light beige part, 1359 to 1451, where they really start to expand outwards. Big chunk of Greece and is to Eastern Europe, most of what today is Turkey. The purple, 1451 to 1581, higher up into Eastern Europe. All right, even along here, what today would be Ukraine, all of modern day Turkey. And then the green, you see by the 1500s, how they've got pretty much the entire Middle East. All right, today what would be parts of Iraq, Jordan, Syria, Egypt down here. Okay, so big, big empire. Now, the Osmans, all right, the guy that I told about who founded this dynasty, his name in Arabic was Uthman. And as Europeans incorrectly, you know, start to learn his name, they called them Ottomans, hence the name, right? The followers of what they thought was Ottoman. Now, what really got the Ottomans credibility as the power in the region, though, was the conquest of Constantinople. Let me first erase all this. Okay. Now, Constantinople, we should remember at this point, was the capital of the Byzantine Empire and had been one of the largest and most successful cities in the world since Roman times. By 1453, though, the Byzantine Empire was down to practically nothing. All right, this is what the Byzantine Empire looked like in 1453. You got a tiny little bottom tip of Greece, you got a little area up here in Asia Minor, and then just Constantinople. That was it. Everything else, you look. Ottoman Sultanate, Ottoman Sultanate. All right, by the mid 1400s, the Ottomans had taken over pretty much the entire territory surrounding Constantinople. But the Byzantines felt that as long as they held on to Constantinople, it could hold on to some of that old Roman glory. Well, in 1453, the Sultan Mehmet II marched his armies to the walls of the city and, using new cannon technology, laid siege to the city for 54 days. All right, he actually had the largest cannon in the world at that point. Built and, you know, brought it up and just pummeled the city for almost 2 months. It eventually did fall, and the Turks renamed it Istanbul, all right, which is still its name to this day. You can see it here. All right, so this is a modern day map of Turkey, and even though it's not the capital of the city, Istanbul, that's where it is up here, all right, the exact same spot where Constantinople was. All right. This conquest of Constantinople was significant for a couple of reasons. One, it firmly establishes the Turks as a dominant power in both Europe and Asia. And the other was that it officially ended the Byzantine Empire. And this ended the last remnants of the old Roman Empire that went back to ancient times. So now that we know a bit about the Ottoman history of conquest, let's take a look at some aspects of their society. Ottoman society was broken down very similar to that of all societies we've learned this year, with certain groups getting higher status in society than others. It was divided into four basic divisions. Now, within these divisions, you had smaller subdivisions, but these were your four main categories. First, you had what were called men of the sword. These were your soldiers, your warriors. The Ottomans were known as being very formidable warriors. Like all Turks, they retained some of their nomadic heritage by being skilled archers and horse riders, so they were no joke on the battlefield. Next, you have men of the pen. These are your academics, your scholars, lawyers, poets. Ottoman society gave them a high status, showing its value of learning and scholarship. After them, the men of negotiation. Merchants made up the bulk of this group. Now, negotiation is essentially what merchants do, right? If negotiate means to bring about through discussion and deal making, then that's what merchants do. They make deals by haggling with buyers and sellers. Artisans were also included in this group, so this group makes up your basic middle class. And lastly, you have the men of husbandry. Now, husbandry is just a fancy word for the care of crops and animals or farming. Okay, so these are your farmers, your herders, your agricultural laborers, and like in all societies that we talked about, they make up the majority of the population. One thing to note in all of these categories, they're all called men, all right, men of something. It's patriarchal values. Women were defined by what their husbands did, so women themselves did not really fit into any of these categories. So warriors were given very high status, but there's one specific group of warrior soldiers I want to give mention to, and that's the Janissaries. Now, despite the fact that they wear some pretty funky headdress, all right, don't let that fool you. These guys were no joke. They were the elite commanders of the army. As I said, not only were they the commanders, but they typically were the most skilled fighters, and they were personally responsible for guarding the life of the Sultan, the emperor of the empire. They achieved such a high level of skills because they were forced into service in childhood. They were taken as boys and underwent rigorous training. Now, a very interesting aspect of Janissaries was that they were very rarely Turks themselves. They were more often taken from conquered people. As the Turks expanded their empire beyond their homeland, the Sultan started a policy of taking young boys from conquered land, especially Christian lands. And they would train them to be this elite fighting force. It was a way to control the conquered people. It took a chunk of those people's male population that could possibly fight against the Turks, and it essentially brainwashed them into becoming the Turks' most loyal and devout soldiers. All right, so let's move on to the Safavid Empire. Now, I'm not going to be spending a lot of time on this, but the most important thing to know is for the Safavid Empire is that we're talking about Persia. Right, the Ottoman Empire is Turkey, and the Safavid Empire is Persia, or today is Iran. Now, let's take a look at the map, and you'll see the big three Muslim empires of the time. Here you've got the Ottoman Empire in green, right? That is mostly Turkey, as I said before, and then you got big chunks of the Middle East, you got Greece, you got Egypt and so forth. You've got the Mughal Empire that we talked about in the previous section in northern India, and then this big one in the middle, that's your Safavid Empire, and you see what's here? Persia, all right? Now, a very important thing to remember about the Safavids was that they were Shiites. Now, we better remember by now that Shiites are Muslims who believe that the leader of Islam should come from Muhammad's descendants. Now, remember the map we looked at back in section 2 that showed the Sunni and Shiite populations today? Here it is again. The light green are Sunnis. They make up the vast majority of the world's population. The dark green are countries that have a Shiite majority. The only significant sized country that has a Shiite majority is right here, Iran. Now you look on the map, all right, that's pretty much where Persia was. Okay. The reason why Iran has a Shiite majority today is because of the Safavid Empire, is because the Safavids established Shiism as being the dominant form of Islam in their empire. Now, the Safavid Empire was not ruled by a caliph or a sultan, but rather a shah. Now, let's get rid of that map. We don't need it there. Which was a Safavid term for king. All right, so that's really all it means. It means king. This title would be used by rulers in Iran until the late 20th century, actually, right? Right up until 1979, the ruler of Iran was known as the Shah. Now, the most prominent of the Safavid Shahs, though, was this dude, Shah Abbas. Now, aside from rocking a phenomenal mustache, Abbas was a big-time reformer, and he was responsible for reforms such as centralizing the government, meaning giving more power to himself, He modernized the military, especially with the use of gunpowder. All right, you notice how up here they referred to these as the gunpowder empires. They made regular use of cannons, and Abbas wanted to keep up with the Ottomans and the Mughals, right? They were pinned in between them. So he says, in order for us to maintain our independence, we got to have the same type of weapons. And like the Mughal Empire, Akbar the Great, that we talked about towards the end of the last section, he was big on strengthening the economy, okay, improving trade relations with people, not only from within his own empire, but outside as well. Now, Abbas's reforms didn't last much past his death, and the Safavid dynasty eventually would fall into decline. But still, establishing Shiism as being the dominant form of Islam would have very, very important effects even into the modern world, as I just mentioned. All right, so that's it for section 5, and that is also it for chapter 10.